Magandang araw mga kapamilya. Today is Saturday, Memorial of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Our Mass Presider is Father Tito Caluag. Entrance Antiphone. The Lord said, I think thoughts of peace and not of affliction. You will call upon me and I will answer you, and I will lead back your captives from every place.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My dear brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins and ask the Lord for pardon and strength. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
And let us pray. Grant us, O merciful God, protection in our weakness, that we who keep the memorial of the Holy Mother of God may, with the help of her intercession, rise up from our iniquities. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first book of Maccabees. As King Antiochus was traversing the inland provinces, he heard that in Persia there was a city called Elymais, famous for its wealth in silver and gold, and that its temple was very rich, containing gold helmets, breastplates, and weapons there, left there by Alexander, son of Philip, king of Macedon, the first king of the Greeks. He went therefore and tried to capture and pillage the city, but he could not do so because his plan became known to the people of the city, who rose up in battle against him. So he retreated and in great dismay withdrew from there to return to Babylon. While he was in Persia, a messenger brought him news that the armies sent into the land of Judah had been put to flight, that Lysias had gone at first with a strong army and been driven back by the children of Israel, that they had grown strong by reason of the arms, men, and abundant possessions taken from the armies they had destroyed, that they had pulled down the abomination which he had built upon the altar in Jerusalem, and that they had surrounded with high walls both the sanctuary, as it had been before, and his city of Beth-Zur. When the king heard this news, he was struck with fear and very much shaken. Sick with grief because his designs had failed, he took to his bed. Then he remained many days overwhelmed with sorrow, for he knew he was going to die. So he called in all his friends and said to them, "Sleep has departed from my eyes, for my heart is sinking with anxiety. I said to myself, into what tribulation have I come, and in what floods of sorrow am I now? Yet I was kindly and beloved in my rule, but I now recall the evils I did in Jerusalem, when I carried away all the vessels of gold and silver that were in it, and for no cause gave orders that the inhabitants of Judah be destroyed. I know that this is why these evils have overtaken me, and now I am dying in bitter grief in a foreign land." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord.
I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord.
I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will declare all your wondrous deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, Most High.
I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord.
Because my enemies are turned back, overthrown and destroyed before you, you rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. Their name you blotted out forever and ever.
I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord.
The nations are sunk in the pit they have made. In the snare they set, their foot is caught. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, nor shall the hope of the afflicted forever perish.
I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia. Our Savior Jesus Christ has destroyed death and brought life to light through the gospel. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A proclamation of the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Some Sadducees, those who deny that there is a resurrection, came forward and put this question to Jesus, saying, Teacher, Moses wrote for us, if someone's brother dies, leaving a wife but no child, his brother must take up the wife and raise up descendants for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first married a woman but died childless. Then the second and the third married her, and likewise all the seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. Now at the resurrection, whose wife will this woman be? For all seven had been married to her. Jesus said to them, The children of this age marry and remarry. But those who are deemed worthy to attain to the coming age and to the resurrection of the dead, neither marry nor are given in marriage. They can no longer die, for they are like angels, and they are the children of God because they are the ones who will rise. That the dead will rise again, will rise, even Moses made known in the passage about the bush, when he called Lord the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And he is not God of the dead, but of the living. For to him all are alive. Teacher, you have answered well, and they no longer dared to ask him anything. My dear brothers and sisters, the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And here you have a very, I think, very interesting and very important gospel, actually, you know, about the question of the resurrection. No? If yesterday in our reflections we talked about also the place of eventually suffering, no, and making sacrifices and taking a stand, no, so that is the, you might say, that is the virtue that we pray for in this life, no, and here you have the horizon, no, the end of our journey, no? Remember what the famous Stephen Covey rule, no, is that begin with the end in mind, no, and here the whole mystery of the resurrection is precisely the end of our Christian living, of our human existence. So this is the beginning with the end in mind, no? that the horizon of our journey, of our discipleship, is the resurrection. So that's the context of our reflections for today. No? So first, no, we begin precisely with that, no? How central the resurrection is into our faith life, no? Into our journey as followers of Christ. No? And then the second point that I invite you to reflect on is that in the end, no, when we think of the resurrection, when we talk about the resurrection, it is always a question of eternal life, no. So that's a second point, no. And then the third and last point is that how the resurrection really is, you know, what you might call a game changer, no. Everything shifts because of the mystery of the resurrection, no. First about the resurrection as central to our faith, no. That I think what is important for us is to reflect on how has the resurrection shaped our life, no? Do we live our lives, no, precisely being confident, no, and having the faith and the hope that everything in this life has meaning because of the resurrection, no? So for me, that is a very important thing to reflect on. That's why the first point that I invite you to do this weekend, no, for the first point for our reflection is, for you, what is the meaning of the resurrection? What has been the influence, no, of the resurrection in your life, no? How has that somehow influenced the way you live your life, and especially the way you live your life as a follower of Christ? So that first point to reflect on, no? what is the real impact of the resurrection in our day-to-day life, no? And then the second point is that as I said, that the resurrection is always associated with eternal life, no. And remember what we've reflected on several times in the past, no. When someone asked me if I believed in eternal life, of course I said yes, no. And then she asked, no, what is eternal life for me, no? And then I thought about it, and then my answer was, eternal life is the good that we do in this lifetime, no. Because the good things, no, the good deeds that we do is what will last for a lifetime, no? Beyond our lifetime, rather, no? It is what we leave behind to others, no? The good that we shared with them, that will always be remembered by others, no? So that is eternal life. That is part of eternal life, no? The good that we do in this world, no? In our lifetime here, no? And I think precisely, remember that famous saying, no? From, I think, the Buddhist saying that what we have done will not be lost to all eternity. Everything ripens and bears fruit in its own hour. That is part of the grace of the resurrection, no? That all the things that we do in this life will somehow bear fruit, no? In eternity, no? So that second point to reflect on, no? And then the third and final point is to ask ourselves, no? About the horizon as the resurrection of our lives and how this has become, as I would always want to put it, a game changer. Knowing that everything that we do, we will have meaning, because life will not end in death, but there is the transition to eternal life. There is the resurrection. So everything, the entire perspective changes because of that. And hopefully with the shift of the perspective, the way we will live our lives, we will also shift, no? Totally dedicated and devoted and tending towards the gift of the resurrection. Siguro mahalaga na pagnilayan natin itong mga puntong ito. Lalong-lalo na ngayon, no? Pagtatapos ng taon ng liturhiya at magsisimula na tayo ng Adbiento sa susunod na linggo, bukas Christ the King, no? Mahalaga na pagnilayan natin itong pinakasentro at pinakabuod, malalim na buod ng ating pananampalataya, ang muling pagkabuhay. Sapagkat ito ang sentral na misteryo ng ating pananampalataya. Lahat ay nakatuon tungo sa muling pagkabuhay, sa resurrection, no? Siguro mahalaga na pagnilayan natin, ano ang naging epekto nito sa ating buhay, no? Ito ba ay merong epekto sa buhay natin? Alam natin na ang ating buhay ay hindi magtatapos sa kamatayan, kundi merong muling pagkabuhay. Merong buhay na walang hanggan, no? Tapos yung pangalawang punto na kaugnay nito, di ba yung napagnilayan natin dati na ano ba ang buhay na walang hanggan, no? At nabahagi ko sa inyo yung kwento na tinanong ako dito at tapos tinanong para sa akin ano raw ito. At ang sabi ko, ako naniniwala na ang buhay na walang hanggan ay ang kabutihan na ginawa natin sa buhay na ito. Ito ang patuloy na mabubuhay sa mga buhay ng ibang tao, sa mga puso ng ibang tao, yung mga taong ginawa natin ng kabutihan. Dito pa magpapatuloy, ano, ang ating ginawa, no? At sabi nga, 'di ba, ng isang kasabihan ng mga Buddhist, no? Lahat ng ginawa natin dito ay magbubunga sa buhay na eternal, no? Sa buhay na walang hanggan, no? At yung pangatlo, huling punto ay yung ating pananaw sa buhay ay nagbago dahil sa muling pagkabuhay. Yung abot-tanaw, yung horizon ng ating buhay ay nagbago dahil sa muling pagkabuhay. Dahil alam natin na hindi magtatapos sa kamatayan ang ating paglalakbay, no, sa mundo, kundi ito ay muling magpapatuloy, no, sa buhay na walang hanggan sa pamamagitan ng muling pagkabuhay ng Panginoon. Today, let us reflect on this, especially as we come to the Feast of Christ the King and prepare for the first Sunday of Advent. It would be nice for us to realize, no, how the resurrection, the mystery, and the grace of the resurrection has somehow, in a sense, reoriented our life. How glorious is the peace and hope of the resurrection. Let us pray with hearts set free from foolish doubt or hesitation, because we believe in the promise of Jesus who rose from the dead.
That the Church throughout the world may continue to preach the good news of the resurrection and the life of the world to come, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That in our daily lives we may bring the light of hope to those who live in darkness and despair, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the poor, the homeless, and the needy may experience the Lord of life in the love and generosity of those who are kind to them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And let us remember all the intentions commended to our prayers at this Mass. We pray especially for the intentions of the Holy Father, his intentions for peace, most especially, And we also pray for all the souls of the faithful departed, especially commended to our prayers during our November Masses. For all this we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that this our sacrifice may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy Church.
Receive, O Lord, we ask, the prayers of your people with the sacrificial offerings, that through the intercession of Blessed Mary, the Mother of your Son, no petition may go unanswered, no request be made in vain, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, and to praise, bless, and glorify your name in veneration of the Blessed Ever Virgin Mary. For by the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit, she conceived her only begotten Son, and without losing the glory of virginity, brought forth into the world the eternal light, Jesus Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the night that he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, he gave you thanks. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, he gave you thanks and praise. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, this life-giving bread, this saving cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your Church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Onesto, our Bishop, the clergy, the entire people your Son has gained for you. Accept, Father Most Holy, all the intentions commended to our prayers at this Mass. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. We pray most specially for all the souls of the faithful departed, commended to our prayers during our November Masses. Welcome them, Lord, into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit
to be co-heirs to eternal life and praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Lord, we beg you not to look on our sins, but on the faith of your church. And grant us the peace, the unity, and the joy of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us offer each other the sign of peace. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
My dear brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away our sins, the sin of the world. Happy are we who are called to share in the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen. An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let's spend a few moments of silence. And together now, let us offer Pope Francis's prayer for peace.
Lord God of peace, King of heaven and earth, hear our prayer. We have tried so many times and over so many years to resolve our conflicts by our own powers and by the force of our arms. How many moments of hostility and darkness have we experienced? How much blood has been shed? How many lives have been shattered? How many hopes have been buried? But our efforts have been in vain. Now, Lord, come to our aid. Grant us peace, teach us peace. Guide our steps in the way of peace. Open our eyes and our hearts and give us the courage to say, never again war. With war, everything is lost. Instill in our hearts the courage to take concrete steps to achieve peace. Lord, God of love, you created us, and you call us to live as brothers and sisters. Give us the strength daily to be instruments of peace. Enable us to see everyone who crosses our path as our brother or sister. Make us sensitive to the plea of our citizens who entreat us to turn our weapons of war into implements of peace, our trepidation into confident trust, and our quarreling into forgiveness. Keep alive within us the flame of hope, so that with patience and perseverance, we may opt for dialogue and reconciliation. In this way, may peace triumph at last, and may the words division, hatred, and war be banished from the heart of every man and woman. Lord, diffuse the violence of our tongues in our hands. Renew our hearts and minds, so that the word which always brings us together will be brother, sister, and our way of life will always be that of shalom, peace, salam. Amen. Our Lady, Queen of Peace, pray for us.
And let us pray.
Having been made partakers of eternal redemption, we pray, O Lord, that we who commemorate the mother of your Son may glory in the fullness of your grace and experience its continued increase for our salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And Almighty God bless us, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.
Marami pong salamat. And again, please join us for Project Filipino and also for Journeys of Hope. And tomorrow, remember, is the Feast of Christ the King. No? So marami pong salamat. Have a good weekend ahead. Thank you po.
Ako si Father Tony Labiao Jr., Executive Director ng Caritas Philippines. Ang Caritas Philippines ay mayroong 7 Alay Kapwa Legacy Programs, Alay sa Karunungan, Alay sa Kalusugan, Alay sa Kabuhayan, Alay sa Kasanayan, Alay sa Katugunan sa Kalamidad, Alay sa Kalikasan, at Alay sa Katarungan at Kapayapaan. Comprehensive yung programa na binibigyan din natin sila ng pagkakataon na magkaroon ng kabuhayan at ang environment nila ay magkaroon ng halimbawa. Access nila sa palengke, sa paaralan, sa kabuhayan nila. Ito ay nagbibigay ng panibagong pangarap, panibagong pag-asa sa mga mamamayan. Diyan mo makikita yung ngiti ba ng mga pamilya na pagkatapos ng kalamidad, akala nila tapos na rin ang kanilang buhay, pero nagkaroon sila ng panibagong pag-asa dahil sa tulong ninyo.
This is what we can share. This is our Alay Kapwa.